Good morning. Take your hymnals, please. Turn to page number 804. 804, stand with us and let's sing the Battle Hymn of the Republic. Page 804. And please stand with us and sing that first.
Mine eyes have seen the glory of the coming of the Lord. He is trampling out the vintage where the grapes of wrath are stored. He has loosed the faithful lightning, his terrible swift sword. His truth is marching on. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. His truth is marching on. I have seen him in the watchfires of 100 circling camps. They have builded him an altar in the evening dews and damps. I can read his righteous sentence by the dim and flaring lamps. His day is marching on. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. His truth is marching on.
Sing out last.
We can almost hear the trumpet sound. The Lord's return is near. There are still so many people lost. His message they must hear. Father, give us one more moment, one more day, just one more year. With God we're marching on. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. His truth is marching on.
Amen. Thank you. Please be seated. And listen as our choir sings, Onward, Christian Soldiers.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, choir. Take your hymnals once again, please. Page 342, Rock of Ages, please stand with us. Page number 342, and please stand with us. Sing that first.
Rock of Ages, cleft for me, let me hide myself in thee. Let the water and the blood from thy wounded side which flowed be of sin the double cure. Save from wrath and make me pure.
As the instruments play through that a couple of times, get around, shake hands with your neighbor. And if we have any visitors, tell them you're glad to have them here with us. And sing that second verse with me, please.
Could my tears, thy cross I'll cling.
Sing that last verse.
While I draw this fleeting breath, when my eyes shall close in death, when I rise to worlds unknown and behold thee on thy throne, Rock of Ages, cleft for me, let me hide myself in thee.
Amen, and thank you. Please be seated, Brother Ben.
Well, good morning, everyone. Welcome to Pioneer Baptist Church. Special welcome to the veterans. Happy Veterans Day to those of you who have served. We certainly appreciate your service. And not to be missed, happy birthday, Marines. 244 years young. Happy birthday. I look forward to the Veterans Day service today. We'll have a little presentation coming up in a little while, so I look forward to that. We do have some coming events. Tuesday, November 26th, we're going to move our Wednesday evening midweek service to Tuesday to accommodate the Thanksgiving festivities to come after that, so people have time to travel and still be with their families. Tract distribution, Saturday, December 7th, followed by our Christmas Kids program on December 8th. It'll be during the evening service, Sunday, December 8th, the Bible Tells Me So show. That's a mouthful. But we look forward to that. The kids are doing a lot of work under the tutelage of Mrs. Mitchell and the younger Mrs. Swears. So appreciate the work going on there. Plan to be here for that. We do have some birthdays. John Hackbong. John. There's John behind the camera. Happy birthday to John. I think it's today. Happy birthday, sir. Ashley's birthday tomorrow. Nursery? Yeah. Ashley's in the nursery. Lingra's birthday? Wednesday. Happy birthday to Lingra. And we've got a special anniversary this week. Enoch, you should make your way down here. There's a comma in there. I know I ran right through it. There's a special anniversary this week, comma. It is not you and I, me. Don't worry, you didn't forget. It's Mike and Julie, and we're not going to have him lead his own song. Any other birthdays or anniversaries this week that we're missing? All right. Well, sir, why don't we do happy anniversary first?
All right.
Allow you to join your bride. Get up.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, God bless you. Happy anniversary to you.
Now let's do happy birthday. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, God bless you. Happy birthday to you.
I want to take a little shot in the dark here. We've, on Veterans Day, we've tried to do a couple things a little differently, and I've had some highly decorated people speak on occasion. But there's another good speaker here that doesn't speak very often, and that would be Larry Owens. Was in the real military, the Marines. Larry, will you come up here and just share a couple of thoughts? I didn't tell him about this, and I know he's going to be reluctant, but he's a good speaker. Just any thoughts you have about the military. How much you hated Air Force officers, anything. Yeah, right, there you go.
Well, thank you. No, Veterans Day means a lot to a lot of us. Some of us out there have served, and really, I didn't happen to have to go to Vietnam, but I know a lot of people did, and some of my friends didn't come back, and the way they were treated when they came back still does not set well with me, but that's the way it was. But I appreciate all the vets, and I don't know why you put me on this spot, but you do. But anyway.
I don't see you that often. I like you to hear from me when I do.
This is all you're getting out of me. Thank you.
All right, well, gentlemen, if you'll come, we'll take an offering.
Good-looking guys, huh?
Amen. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you, God, for meeting with us this morning. We do thank you, Lord, for our country. We thank you for preserving it. God, it's all through your blessings. And, Lord, one of the ways that you've enabled it is through our military. And God, we've got veterans here today, and we certainly are thankful for their service, Lord. They've helped to preserve a freedom of religion in this country, and for that, we should never forget it, Lord, and we thank you for it. We ask you to continue to bless our country, God. Lift us up all the way to the top, Lord, with our leaders. God, have them to be focused on you, to be focused on biblical principles, and Lord, to not turn your back on you, because we know what can happen when that happens, Lord. We pray that you would bless our time here this morning. Take this offering, bless it, multiply it, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, ladies. Take your hymnals one last time, please. Page 807. Stand with us. My country, 'tis of thee. Page 807. Please stand with us. Sing that first.
My country, 'tis of thee, sweet land of liberty, of thee I sing. Land where my fathers died, land of the pilgrim's pride, from every mountainside, let freedom ring.
Okay, kids, you're dismissed. Sing that last verse.
Our Father's God, to thee, author of liberty, to thee we sing. Long may our land be bright with freedom's holy light. Protect us by thy might, great God, our King.
Amen. And thank you. Please be seated. And right now we have Julie to come and sing for us.
Place your hand on his Bible when you swear to tell the truth. His name is on our greatest monuments, all our money too. And when we pledge allegiance, there's no doubt where we stand. There's no separation, we're one nation under him. In God we still trust. In America, he's the one to turn to every time the going gets rough. He is the source of all our strength, the one who watches over us. Here in America, in God we still trust. Now there are those among us who wanna push him out and erase his name from everything this country's all about. From the schoolhouse to the courthouse, there's silence in his word. But now it's time for all believers to make our voices heard. In God we still trust. Here in America, he's the one to turn to every time the going gets rough. He is the source of all our strength, the one who watches over us. Here in America, in God we still trust. Here in America, here in America, here in America, in God we still trust. Here in America, in God we still trust.
Thank you, Julie and choir, congregation. How about we ask all the veterans to stand? Would you stand right now so we can just at least give you a hand? All right. God bless you guys. Thank you very much. Thank you for your service. And if we didn't get you in the video, we'll get you in next year. Amen. If the Lord tarries and we're still kicking. But we got a little video here. We'll play in a little while. But today is the day that we honor United States military veterans. It's officially Veterans Day, and by the way, there's no apostrophe there. It's not V-E-T-E-R-A-N apostrophe S, or nor does the apostrophe follow the S like it does on Mother's Day or Father's Day or all of that. The name of the holiday, the word veterans, acts as an attributive noun. Now, I wouldn't know what that is except for the next statement, which means that it behaves like an adjective even though it's a noun. So it's Veterans Day, and it's V-E-T-E-R-A-N-S. And here's what my friend dictionary.com has to say about the word veteran. It's a person who has had long service or experience in an occupation, office, or the like. Or it's a person who served in a military force, and it adds on especially one who has fought in a war. Now we've got Steve Cederbacher and Larry Solis and Norm Hofer. And I get confused on with the general, Mr. Elisarius. I get confused as to whether it was World War II at the end of the Korean War. Which is it? World War II vet. How about that? How many of those left? And if they are, they don't look as good as Elisarius. Thank you very much. You may be seated. We appreciate those. And you know, I didn't go to war. I was in there during the Vietnam War and would have gone, but didn't get chosen to go. And but those that went and fought, and the real combat veterans, it seems like they're all alike in certain respects. And I don't know if you found this to be true, Larry, they seem to defer praise. Have you found that to be true? You know, the guys that have been in combat, they defer that praise. They don't want to be singled out and indicate, yeah, hey, we're all the same, we all served and all of that. But those guys where the bullets were flying, especially, you know, I got a real soft spot in my heart for those that went, and some of them came back hurt badly. Many lost their lives, might talk about that for a second a little later. And then some came back fine, at least mentally, but that whole PTSD thing has affected so many different people over the years. And war can be a terrible thing, and yet for America, it's been a necessary thing. And a country without a strong military, go see what happened to Poland when Hitler walked in there. And you find out what happens if we don't have a strong military. So I'm all for having the best men and women and the best weapons and the strongest resolve so that we maintain our freedom in America. I'm sure there are plenty of people that would take it away, and we can thank God we're free. We get up in the morning, go where we want to go. We pursue the occupation we want to pursue. We go worship God the way we choose to do. And we can thank the veterans for that. At any rate, we see the word veteran is a very good word. It speaks of good things and brings thoughts of respect and admiration. You know, I can't speak for anybody else, but I think all of us. And when I this week took a brief time to reflect upon the word veteran and Veterans Day, four descriptive words jumped into my head. these four words, summed up my description of veteran, if not the definition, of who, to me at least, a veteran is. And I'm going to give you those four words real quickly. Number one is service. If you're a veteran, you had some longevity of service. We got 20 men, and even more than that. Some of the generals and things are in a long time, and chief master sergeant, and those upper echelon of the enlisted ranks, they can get beyond 20, and some do. That's service. And you've also exhibited honorable service. Of course, anybody can apply, you know, challenge anything, but if you got a dishonorable discharge, we don't look at that as a real service, amen? I mean, you know, I don't know what happened. I'm not the judge. But we look at people that had served honorably, and all the men and women here did that. So we look at service first when we look at a veteran. They served. then sacrifice. It always costs something to serve. It's never easy to serve. It always costs something. For one thing, I found your pay is usually not what others are earning. Now, some people thought maybe I was overpaid when I was in the military. However, your pay is usually not what others are earning. That's one thing in terms of sacrifice. Another thing, I think you ladies and gentlemen will agree with me on this, your location is where you're needed, not where you want or are wanted. I sat in San Antonio. Yeah, it was San Antonio. And I was in security police, and we're wrapping up our security police training. And the man came over that actually was one of the guys that assigned us to our locations. And the guy says, Mitchell, where are you from? I said, from Maine. And they had already assigned me to Whiteman Air Force Base in Missouri. And he laughed, and he said, we didn't get you too close to home, did we? Well, that's the way it goes in the military, amen? I guess you probably didn't really say, when they asked you what you'd like for a location, you probably didn't say Vietnam. Same way with Brother Siedebacher, probably the same way with you, Noam, and say, where do you want to go? I'd like to go to Vietnam. I'd like to sleep in a river and live in the jungle, you know? I don't think so. You see, part of the sacrifice is your location. You go where you're needed, not where you want to be or are wanted. My mother probably would have liked to have me close to home. At least that's what she said when I wasn't close to home. What about your duties? Your duties are as dictated by your commander-in-chief. Now, it doesn't go all the way up to the commander-in-chief. It filters its way down. But there are some military expressions for that, too. But we won't mention them here. But your duties get filtered down to you. So now, say, well, boy, I don't really like what I'm doing. Well, the guy that assigned you doesn't care if you like it or not. Amen? You do what you're told to do. That's part of your sacrifice. And your personal risk usually outweigh your personal reward. Steve is in there taking care of the money. Do you remember how much you were making when you were in Vietnam as a tunnel rat? How many weeks? Every 2 weeks. 145. Okay, what's that? 290 a month? 390 a month? 290 a month. $290 a month. Now, you could have got killed, right? Yeah, how about that? You want that job? Now, with inflation, what would that be? You'd probably be getting $1,000 a month, maybe, today. $1,000 a month to go shoot and get shot. Set off a tripwire, and they find different parts of your body in different locations. Amen? Or, God help you if you get captured by the Viet Cong. But you're getting $1,000 a month. Listen, your personal risk far outweigh your personal reward. I didn't say you didn't serve out of love of country. You did. I'm not saying you weren't willing to give your life. One of the things I liked about when I was a kid reading social studies, we called it, history, was Nathan Hale. And Carlo and I were there, right by the room where Nathan Hale lived at Yale University, I think his freshman year. But they hanged him for being a spy. And they attributed to him that he said, I have but one regret, that I only have but one life to give for my country. Now the revisionist history people question that, of course, like they question anything good, right? The only thing they don't question on revisionist history is what is bad. They don't question that. If they can find something bad about you after you die, listen, that'll be fact. But if I find something good about you, they'll question that right and left. Amen? I think Sergeant Solis has to leave for another call of duty. Is that correct? Okay, man. Well, thanks for being here. You're looking good. Okay. All right. Simplify. All righty. Anyway, your personal risks are great. And we say this, it's a cliche, I believe it. Some gave all gave some. Larry mentioned friends of his on the wall. Wayne Watts, I've talked about him, a friend of mine that was killed in Vietnam. He was on a helicopter, and some of the tributes say that partially because of his death, they got this armor, the armored vests and things that would stop these armor-piercing bullets and things, and they all got outfitted with them. Well, he got shot in the chest, it got him in his heart, and he died. And he was a wonderful friend and a wonderful guy, and we think of people that gave their lives. So sacrifice. When I think of a veteran, I think of service. I think of sacrifice. And everybody that served in the United States military sacrificed something. Then the suffering. Your service may include wounds and loss of life. People get hurt terribly. When it comes to bullets are flying, somebody's going to get hurt. Bombs are going off, somebody's going to get hurt. Your enemies are real and they're lethal. They want to kill you. I mean, I hate to even say it, but what is war but going out and killing people? That's what it is. Kill them before they kill you. What a sad fact of life. And we get these young people and put a uniform on them and train them and send them out. And their enemies are real and they're lethal. And then, what we all know, whether we went to combat or not, your superiors may be harsh and unsympathetic. I got a haircut today, so it'd be within regulation. Got it last night from my personal barber, Carla Mitchell. But I remember the recruiter, Sergeant Corriveau, and guys would look at his haircut and say, "Can I have a haircut like yours?" He says, "I've got it, haven't I?" He was a recruiter. And then when you went to basic training, you went to the barber shop. And they took out something, and I had a kind of an afro type thing for a white guy. And he took those things and he made a cross right on my head. They made you bald. You got up in the morning and went down to the latrine to shave, and you looked in the mirror. You didn't know if you were shaving you or the guy next to you. Everybody looked alike, bald. Amen? And your superiors don't care about any of that. They're not handing out participation trophies in the military. Maybe after the fact, but not before or during. I mean, I got yelled at more in officer's training school than some of you have in the whole course of your marriage. And I got called everything. "You want to be an officer in the United States Air Force? You make me sick." Did they give you stuff like that, Larry, in the Marines too? Oh, yeah. Yeah, you go in there thinking they're going to be happy that you joined up and you want to serve your country? No, they hate you. They want to decimate you, destroy you, and defile you in every possible way. Suffering. Even if you didn't go to combat, you suffered when you're in basic training. Steve told me, he said they had to hold this old rifle. It was heavy out there. And if their knees started buckling, they got in trouble. And so one of those guys came by and hit him in the head with the butt of his gun. You know? You're saying, "Wait a minute, does this make any sense?" Well, sometimes these trainers in the military aren't that smart, okay? How they got the position, I don't know, but they're not that smart. So you get suffering. So when I think of a veteran, I think of service, I think of sacrifice, I think of suffering. And then I think of success. For the veteran, honorably completing your enlistment period is success. If you finished your enlistment and did so honorably, I count that to be success. I count faithfulness to be the greatest indicator of success. When we're all done, we look at that and say, was he faithful, was she faithful during her term of service? And that's success. Well, let me keep going a minute. That's who veterans are. They're men and women who have served, sacrificed, suffered, and been faithfully successful. And by the way, Vietnam War was my war. They're all tough, amen? They're all unbelievably tough. World War II, every one of them. But listen to this about Vietnam. There are 58,267 names on the wall. That's 58,000 people that gave their lives during the Vietnam War. 39,996 of them were just 22 years old or younger. 22 years old. Most of us can't remember when we were 22. 8,283 of them were 19 years old. 33,103 were 18 years old. If you're 18 years old, if you're 19 years old or younger, right now, stand up. Boys, girls, both. Stand up if you're 19 or younger. Orlando, how old are you? 13. 17. 17. Matt. 18. Noah. Go ahead to Larry's grandkids. 14. Thank you. Be seated. All right, we got people here that just stood up that were older than people that gave their lives in Vietnam. I haven't finished the list yet. 12 were 17 years old. 5 were 16 years old. Now, you think about that and think about the cost of war and what they gave. There are 3 sets of fathers and sons on the wall. There are 31 sets of parents who lost 2 of their sons. 997 were killed on their first day there. 1,445 were killed on their last day there. You could say they were all killed on their last day there, but at their time of enlistment. There are 8 women on the wall, nurses. 244 were awarded the Medal of Honor during the war, and 153 of them are on the wall. The Revolutionary War, we lost deaths, 4,435. War of 1812, 2,260. Mexican War, 13,283. Civil War, 618,000. Everybody that died in the Civil War was an American, basically. Both sides, 618,000. Spanish-American War, 2,446. World War I, 116,516. World War II, 405,399. Korean War, 36,574. And other things that aren't on this list, that all of the wars in the Mideast, I guess we call it. Listen, these veterans have either paid or were willing to pay the ultimate price. No wonder we say we ought to thank a veteran. Today we honor those who have served in the United States Armed Forces. And we've got a little video here, and we can thank God for, do we need to turn the lights out? We can thank God that we got the LEDs or whatever they are in there. So when we turn them out, they come right back on. We don't have to wait 5 minutes. But I hope you enjoy this video. And you won't recognize anybody in it, but you'll enjoy it. Thank you.
complimentary words to the veterans, however, Steve did not write. Those were by a non-veteran, so thank you for all that put that together. And we have a couple of awards that the deacons voted on. Cutis was a tie between Kimmy and Cora. The outstanding ultimate weapon would be Richard Elisiris in the picture. Amen? Anyway, that's all we got. We'll give you the rest tonight. Anyway, while today is the day that we honor the veterans, it's their day exclusively, make no mistake about that, I don't hesitate, and nor am I as a veteran ashamed or blushed, to draw out scripture pointing out that the Christian life is a war against Lucifer and all of his wiles. You can check Ephesians chapter 6, verse 11. We wrestle not against flesh and blood, amen? Principalities, powers, rulers of darkness, all of that. And that it's a constant battle with real and powerful enemies, Ephesians 6, 12. And involved in our Christian service is just that, service and sacrifice. In Romans 12, 1, the Bible says this, I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. We've got sacrifice and service that each of us, you know, we kick stuff around when we're just having a Pepsi and shooting the bull and talking to Dennis yesterday and this morning and things, and talk about people that, well, they're not going to church. You know, you got a chance to go surfing or get over your hangover, why go to church? Right? Takes time, doesn't it? Then the first thing you know, you get to church and they pass the offering plate. Pretty soon it takes sacrifice. Amen? So if you're here today, and you've got a reason for it. Amen. The Lord gave his life for you. Amen? You're not your own. You're bought with a price. But Romans 12, 1, I beseech you by the mercies of God that you present your bodies a living sacrifice. To say, hey, I'm here to serve God. Amen? Amen? And people that have made that decision are a lot different than actually the majority of the world today that aren't bothering to do that. They may give it lip service. You know, the veterans are the guys that served. They're not the guys that talk about serving. They're the guys that did. Amen? Well, somebody, we love to quote this when we're in a teacher training at the college. And somebody, I don't even know who, said, those that can do, those that can't teach. Okay? Well, you know, we used to quote that and get a kick out of it and laugh at our instructors with it behind their backs, of course. But, listen, veterans are people who didn't talk about it, they did. What do we say, show up or shut up, right? Yeah. And these are people that did. And it's a sacrifice and it's a service. And there is suffering there as well. The Apostle Paul charged a Christian servant, Timothy, who was Paul's son in the faith, to endure hardness as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. Endure hardness as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. Look, it's not easy. It's not easy to go out there. You're going to endure hardness. Right. And these people that have gone in and served, well, it's been a battle and they've endured hardness. And God said it in his own word. He made the comparison. I don't have to be ashamed to draw that comparison. Amen. It's Veterans Day. I'm drawing the comparison to Christians. You might hesitate to do that. And yet God did it. And that's the analogy that he used with Timothy. And he also told Timothy this, all that will live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution. Yeah. Now, I got to say, I haven't had a lot of persecution, okay? Maybe somebody snicker at you, laugh at you, or criticize you, whatever. That's hardly the kind of persecution that our forefathers took when they were burned at the stake, yeah, or garroted, or worse. Right. Amen? We just haven't suffered a lot of persecution. And, you know, when somebody laughs at you, you ought to yourself laugh and say, man, that's nothing. You can laugh at me all day long. Are you crazy? I've got my Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. I'm on my way to heaven. He's given me the privilege of serving him. It's not something we deserve. It's not something that we are really capable of doing, as Pastor pointed out in Sunday school this morning. It's something that God, by his grace, allowed us the privilege of serving. And, you know, I think most veterans are proud of their service. We might have had our days when we grumbled a little bit. One of my teachers was Ford Harper, And he said, you know, a good soldier, he'll grumble a little bit about the food or whatever, might complain about his superior officers or whatever the case may be, but he serves. And we might look back and say, well, I didn't like this. I didn't like this guy doing this to me. I'm sure Steve didn't like it when the guy hit him in the side of the head with the butt of a rifle. Okay, we didn't like that stuff. But when we look back at it, I think every veteran is proud of their service. And you Christian veterans, surely, what do we have to brag about in life apart from the fact that we've done something to try to serve God? Amen? I mean, we can't really brag about that. Paul said, I've labored more abundantly than all, yet not I, but the grace of Christ, the grace of God that was with me. So if we've done anything, it's by the grace of God. But Paul also wrote over there, and he said, God forbid that I should glory, save in the cross of my Lord Jesus Christ. Right. Now, we're bragging about Christ, but look, we're proud of what we've done. If we've done anything, it's by the grace of God. And nothing we've done out in the secular world could possibly compare to the fact of going and telling somebody how to get to heaven. What better directions could you give? You know, you give somebody directions, or we'd be in Auburn and somebody would ask me how to get someplace, and I said, follow me, I'll show you how to get over there, you know? Well, we're pretty proud of ourselves for that. Say, I've done my good deed for the day. Well, what does that compare if you told them how to get across a bridge over to Lewiston compared to getting to heaven? And when you've gone out and handed out a tract, when you've witnessed to somebody, when you've given them the chance of eternal life, man, you've done a great thing. There's nothing better than that. So there are legitimate parallels, I would say, and a lofty standard put before us by those we honor today for their military service. It's a challenge of service. We look at the veteran and say, all right, he served. Well, I need to do the same thing for Christ. The challenge of service, the challenge of sacrificing for Christ and suffering for Christ, and that for a noble and unselfish cause. But the parallels don't end there. I know that, you know, it's embarrassing when I point somebody out, but for the fun of it, for my sake, I know that the Galloways have been privileged to be a part of two momentous retirement ceremonies. For their two sons, that would be David and Jason. David retired as a United States Air Force Major, and Jason, a United States Marine Corps Master Sergeant. Great ceremonies. I guess they were, huh? I wasn't at them, but very impressive ceremonies. People had served 20 more years in the military and achieved great things within the military. Both of them served in war combat zones, all of that. Great retirement ceremony. But we need to know, and you need to know, that the Christian veteran's retirement ceremony and the benefits he receives are even greater than those that were experienced there. They're out of this world, amen? That's what we say. We say, yeah, the retirement program's out of this world. There are crowns that we get from the Lord for our medals and ribbons. We get lifetime housing and a mansion, much better than our human commander-in-chief's residence. By the way, that would be Donald Trump, our commander-in-chief. Yeah, and he'll be living there for the next 5 years. But our surroundings are even better than that. And there's a VA center in the New Jerusalem. But there are no medical units there. Since we'll all be perfectly healthy, we won't need any medical units. We'll have a free white dress uniform of spotless righteousness. We'll be passing in review on horseback behind the Supreme General of the universe, the Lord Jesus Christ, and before God the Father, as we return to battle in Revelation 19. And believe me, it's going to be a glorious victory. And say, 1,000 years after that, there will finally be that war to end all wars. And there'll be quite a retirement ceremony. By the way, God alone establishes our date of separation. I've told you about my date of separation. They were given early outs, and I volunteered to go to Vietnam and couldn't go when I wanted to go. And a colonel friend of mine was going over, and I wanted to go with him. Then they started offering early outs because they were winding down in Vietnam. Too many officers. Got to get rid of them. Early outs, 3 months early out. So I went down and applied for an early out. And I went down, never forget, Tech Sergeant Brown. Sergeant Brown, got anything for me today? No, Lieutenant, nothing for you today. He said, wait a minute, let me check. You remember those old teletype things, right? He punched in my stuff and it came punching back. Mitchell Gerald R., First Lieutenant, DOS, date of separation, 14 July 72, and it was late June. He said, man, they've given you a date of separation down at Randolph, and they haven't even told us this. We got to start out processing you today. Boom, I was out. But God, in this Christian service, it's God that establishes our date of separation, amen? And I don't believe it's time to quit until we have to quit. When you can't talk anymore, can't serve anymore, can't walk anymore, can't write letters anymore, well, maybe it's time to just take a little break and let the younger guys take over. But when we do get that date of separation, one of these days in the future, the Lord's going to say to us, well done, thou good and faithful servant. And we have no fear of ever going home in retreat. Every Christian Johnny comes marching home in victory, thanks to the Lord Jesus Christ. We thank God for every U.S. military veteran here today and across the world. And we thank God for every Christian veteran, no matter what. So you take military veterans, we're here to honor you. We're also here to exalt the Lord Jesus Christ. And everyone here that's put their trust in Christ is a Christian veteran, and we thank God for you. And veterans, any kind of veteran, they share a common brotherhood. We share common experiences. We can laugh about it, cry about it. And there is a common and shared understanding and mentality among veterans because you've experienced some of the same things. Now, how does that happen? And why does that happen? Well, I'll tell you why. When our attitude is right for Christians, we have the mind of Christ, our commander-in-chief. So as Christians, we come together, and we've got this common ground of the Bible. We've got the common experience of putting our trust in Christ, of witnessing for Christ, serving, suffering, sacrificing, and we see the success of Christ. We have that. That common bond is Jesus Christ. Now, we've served, we've sacrificed, we've suffered together, and we're proud of our service, and we all share in the victory. And that's what being a veteran really is all about. Regardless of how the battle went, we showed up. That's one thing. They can say, well, you're not much of a Christian. Well, at least I showed up. Amen? That guy that doesn't serve Christ, that guy staying home watching the game of the week or the reruns of the Late, Late, Late Show, that guy can criticize me all he wants to, and they probably will, by the way. But who cares? We're showing up. We get out of bed in the morning. John Foley was my commander in Security Police Squadron at Whiteman. And he said, Mitch, I get up every morning, and I look in that mirror, and I said, John, you're going to do the best job you can for the United States Air Force today. Well, that ought to be our attitude, amen? And when we're right, it is. So we get up, and we say, yes, I'm going to serve God. Yes, we are veterans. And by the way, if you're not a Christian veteran today, there's a reason for it. Number one, you either never took the oath. Amen? December 31st, 1969, I was in Portland, Maine, and I took the oath, and I was in the Air Force then. And unlike some people, I got to drive my car down to San Antonio, and I hopped in my 65 Fastback Mustang on New Year's Day and headed towards San Antonio, wherever that was. Okay? But I took the oath. Now, you say, what do you mean, took the oath? Have you received Christ as your Lord and Savior? When you go to God in prayer and say, look, God, here I am. It's me. I know that I'm a sinner. Bible very clear that all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. I know I deserve hell. I know I'm headed for hell if I don't receive Christ. And I want to put my trust in Jesus Christ today. And in prayer, you ask him in your heart to save you. That's what I'm using as an analogy of taking your oath. If you're not a Christian, you never took the oath. Or maybe you had a profession but no possession. Maybe you took some kind of oath but you never reported for duty. And you're not a veteran. Or maybe you went AWOL, absent without leave. You went over the hill. You know, in days gone by, the penalty for that was death. Paul wrote and said, Demas has forsaken me, having loved this present world. So maybe you're a Christian, but you're not a good veteran because you went AWOL. Now, that's obviously not the case. Well, like Bill Clinton said, I know I'm preaching to the choir. Look, but I'm just saying, if you're here today and say, all this veteran stuff, man, I'm sick of it, it's time to go home. Yeah, we're going home. But I just want to ask you, if you're not a Christian veteran, did you never take the oath? Did you never ask Christ to save you? Because he will. He's not willing that any should perish. He wants you to come. Come unto me, all you that labor and are heavy laden, I'll give you rest. I'll give you a commission, the Great Commission. Or maybe you had a profession but never reported for duty. Well, I didn't really mean that. Or maybe you served for a couple of years and went AWOL and said, oh, man, I'm tired of all this. It's all give and no get. Let me tell you this. Your Supreme Commander-in-Chief, the Lord Jesus Christ, has an amnesty program that you can't beat. And he says this, return unto me and I'll return unto you. I'm not going to put you in the stockade. I'm not going to give you 40 lashes. You want to serve Christ, you come back in. Get back in, re-up as they say, amen? You return unto me and I'll return unto you. In other words, sign up, show up, saddle up, and you can be a veteran. Thank God for you veterans. Military veterans today we honor. But I can never think of a military veteran without thinking of all of you great Christians that have put your hearts, your minds, your souls, and your bodies into serving Christ. And today, while we honor the military veterans, we also take note that the Christian veterans are critical for all eternity. And if I had my choice of which veteran to be, it would be a Christian veteran every time, amen? But the two are not mutually exclusive. So you say, well, you're leaving me out, preacher. No, I'm not. I'm the recruiter. I'm asking you to enlist. Serve God. You'll never regret it. Father, we thank you. We love you. Thank you, God, for being so gracious to us. Thank you, God, for loving us. Thank you, God, for being our leader in the battle. Thank you, God, that you're the most powerful entity, God Almighty, on the face of this earth and beyond, all through the universe. And God, you've never lost a battle, and you never will. When Satan thinks he's got the victory, he's wrong. We read the back of the book, and we know who won. And we know who we serve. And, oh, God, we thank you on Veterans Day with all of our hearts. God, if there's anyone here that needs to sign up and take their oath, might they do it this morning? Thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.